Feature Friday.
The freshest. Alright, hello, what up people, what's going on? Welcome to Feature Friday.
Wow.
Oh my god, that was great.
What the fuck? Wow, let's redo that shit again. anyways, I thought it was a good idea to sort of check out. We did Japanese special about a week and a half, maybe 2 weeks ago. And there's something that a lot of you guys, and I try to read most comments, and there's something that one of you came up with was sort of the idea of, you know, given the fact that we did sort of Korean OSTs and we enjoy that so much, something that it's very important in the whole anime sort of world. It's also, they do have the original soundtracks. Yeah. And they're very sort of popular in Japan, and a lot of very famous bands do them.
It's like, and they become like staple songs around the world. Like, these songs become so popular because of the popularity of the anime itself that, you know, they go across the globe, make, like, everybody knows the songs everywhere. Like, the Naruto one, everybody knows the frigging theme song for that.
Well, I can't remember. I don't think I ever heard the whole thing.
Yeah, and that's the thing. That's the deal about today. I think I am kind of familiar with certain songs here in this list.
I'm not, just one.
But again, I have heard like the 1 minute condensed version that they do for the opening,
intro,
yeah,
stuff like that.
Also,
very peculiarly, is that a word?
Peculiarly, I suppose. It is now.
The boy who came to. Anyway, so something that's very sort of interesting is also that some K-pop bands. Have done some sort of anime OSTs, like Stray Kids, who I think we're going to check out.
I think so, yes.
TXT.
Mm-hmm. So we also have Treasure.
They did one, yeah.
For the new anime called Black Clover, actually.
Right, Stray Kids.
It's been super, super popular, Black Clover. I started watching animes again, like I hadn't done it.
You're
like,
watching that one of Noon, what is it?
Jujutsu Kaisen,
which is similar to Naruto from what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
They do that thing.
But there's like demons and stuff, and like demon spirits and stuff. It's pretty friggin' fun.
Bro, do you like
it's a vibe. It's a vibe.
The only problem is my guess is people that watch anime don't really have a life, because if they're a bit like me.
Accurate.
Because if you watch, like, my problem is if I watch a series, like I just watched the last series I've watched is Vincenzo, right?
Yeah.
And that's probably going to be the last series I watch throughout the whole year. And even though it's fun for Efra's mind to review stuff, it's a bit problematic for me.
Yeah.
Because I have like that obsessive sort of side.
Tendencies.
Yeah, so if I was going to get into an anime, oh, mate, because they're so long, right?
Well,
usually.
That's the thing. That's why I started watching this, because they haven't animated several seasons yet. So there's the book animes, but they haven't animated the, like, the rest of the seasons.
Right.
So there's only season one. It's only 25 episodes long, and each episode is like 20 minutes. So it's like digestible, and I would have to wait for the next season to be dropped.
What is the difference between a webtoon and an anime?
I think it's the fact that whether they're made in Korea or in Japan.
Oh, right, I see.
Yeah, because like mangas and manhwas are like...
So manga is Japanese, manhwas is Korean?
Yeah.
Anime
is the
Japanese.
Cartoon. Yeah, but it's the cartoon, it's the animated.
But it's exclusively
manga.
Japanese.
Mm-hmm.
Right, I see. Because that's sort of very interesting, because I think it was our cousin, she sort of bought this book.
Yeah, Jujutsu Kaisen.
Is that what she bought?
Yeah.
And it looked
so
like,
freaking cool.
Sort of like Marvel Comics, like that.
Mm-hmm.
And that looked awesome.
Amazing. And you read it from the back.
Back to
back
front, because it's right
front.
To left.
Yeah.
Because it's Japan.
Mm-hmm.
They do things right to left.
I didn't know that, but it's
really
cool.
Also, apparently, Arabic is the same as well, right? Right, you read right to left, I think. Could be talking out of my arse. Eh?
No, I think you're correct.
But anyways, enjoy our song. 25.
I love you, Benji.
Never thought that I would lie for your lies.
Like it when I'm sipping on her. Hey, dreaming on her. I just like it when I'm sipping on her. Hey, thinking on her. Thinking it or not, don't stop. Think about it all, don't stop. I just like it when the sun won't stop. Sipping, it's my epitome. I'm just liking the tipping, that's just a sickening. I just like the way you picking, now I'm thinking it. I just like the way you look at me, start licking it. Hey, checking in, stop what you're licking it. Kinda like it when you stop, never sipping it. Kinda like it when you fuck, never tipping it. I just like the way it's rough, yeah, I'm sipping it. Sticking in the back on my truck. Tucking in my past won't stop, yeah, I'm thinking. I got a brand new glove. Now I'm fussing, I got your rap for a buck, hey. Started it. You should've finished when you started it. We never knew what happened, started it. This is when I finished when you started it. I think it's gonna finish, doesn't start again. Why don't you believe me, start a part away? I really think it's time for us to part away. What is starting to start again?
Ooh, who's it gonna be who you're fighting for? Who's it gonna be who you're fighting for? When you're stone
cold. Also, this week's episode is sponsored by
you.
Yeah, I mean, I was going to say, there's been a lot of issues with sort of featurefridaystore.com, but now everything's been resolved because I've been getting a lot of messages about it. No sponsor this week, just merchandise. The website's back up. Featurefridaystore.com is completely up again. And you can
up
get,
and available.
Yeah, you can start ordering again. I know before it was a bit of a pain like the last few months. But now it's everything's happy day. Customer support is back up. Everything's perfect. Yeah, so do feel free to get your merchandise. The good news is, like, this October, now I can actually say, like, new designs will come out and stuff like that. Because before, it was like, how the fuck can we release new designs? Yeah, yeah. If the website, it's up and down and stuff like that. And we were having issues with Teespring. But now all of that's resolved. Also, happy days. Like, bucket hats are coming.
Woohoo!
Cases. Keychains. Yeah,
this is not it though.
No, that's not it. But soon it will be. So do give me some time. But like only a couple of weeks, and then we'll announce everything. Yeah. Also, there'll be like Christmas promotions and Christmas stuff for Future Friday. The whole objective with the merchandise and sort of the clothing line is not for it to be like a YouTube-y sort of merchandise, but actually to feel like a clothing brand.
Yeah, exactly. Something that you can wear all the time, and it doesn't feel like exclusively because of the YouTube channel. Like something.
It's something that hopefully you're
fashionable enough for you to wear around your daily life.
As fashion is also such a huge part of our life, so that's kind of the objective of that. But I just thought I'd share it now because there's been a lot of messages going on. But anyways, let's fucking get to it.
Right. So first off, I don't know where this one is from.
Unravel.
Yeah. So you might want to like do a little bit of research.
As I always say, we're always learning. So do feel free to share all your knowledge in the comment section. I really truly appreciate it because I get to learn through you guys.
And do please bear in mind that even though I used to watch a lot of animes when I was in high school, I haven't in like 10 years.
You were big on anime, weren't you?
Yeah, I was pretty big. Like my group of friends were in school were pretty into animes.
Is Digimon an anime?
I think so.
It's Yu-Gi-Oh!
Yes.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, then I've watched a few.
Yeah. Like
Pokemon.
Yeah.
Oh. Anyway, so this is from Tokyo Ghoul. This is Tokyo Ghoul OST.
Tokyo Ghoul.
Yeah.
All right. That's death. Let's have a look.
Acoustic version, by the way.
Yes, this is the
acoustic
version.
You guys know we love acoustic.
But I think this is just the picture.
My voice, yeah?
Pretty.
Reminds me of a first take, that sort of same equalization. I will get the lyrics, actually.
Yeah, I want lyrics!
Put them up on that screen.
I was gonna say, maybe I can find some, like, images of the anime, because I don't... What is it?
Tokyo Ghoul.
With, like, yes.
Manga series.
Let's have some images.
Oh, Jesus, that looks a bit dark.
Oh, it is very dark. Oh my god. Okay, yes. What is happening here?
Bloody hell.
Psycho look. I love it. Yes.
Tokyo
wow.
Anime.
When did this come out? Looks cool. I wonder what this is about. Let's have a little insight. So.
Do Do you want to read
it? Tokyo Ghoul is a Japanese dark fantasy manga series written by and illustrated by Sui Ishida. And it was serialized as a... Okay, yep. In 2014 September. So I suppose this is very popular, given the fact that this came out in 2014.
Apparently it only has two seasons, because people are asking, is there season three?
Right. Interesting, okay. Lyrics. Love that. I love this.
Everyone keeps searching up season three. Look.
Main characters, yeah. Season three box set.
What the hell is that thing? Amazon assistant.
I don't freaking know. Why are you here, friend? Oh, because you can buy them directly? That's pretty cool.
That's actually smart. That's pretty good.
I love that. All right.
Tokyo Ghoul OST. Tokyo Ghoul,
what is it? Unravel.
Unravel.
Unravel. English lyrics.
Song is by Toru Kitajima. Or Kitajima.
Kitajima. English lyrics. Go, go, go. Giddy, go, go, go. Yes. Okay. Unravel. English lyrics.
Perfect.
All right, all right, all right. Continue in the music. And push. Oh, wonderful, Efra. Look at your mouse pad.
Just for people to read. Fucking sad song.
Yeah, holy crap. It's beautiful though. Alright, it's just full of pain and tension. God. Even in the delivery of the song itself is always right there at the top of his range, right? So it's high, it's painful, it's like kind of like screechy to a certain point, right?
Uneasy, obviously.
Absolutely, and given the lyrics and the dark theme of the visuals that we saw, thanks to Wikipedia and Google, you kind of have this whole idea of a really twisted, painful storyline, I suppose.
It's pretty dark. I mean, it is. Maybe this is also a way, you know, because it's become, maybe, you know, it originated sort of from Japan, right? And maybe this is a way also, you know, art expresses a lot of society sort of concerns and struggles.
Mm-hmm.
This happens all around the world. But maybe, yeah, this sort of, like this sentence, you know, for example, it's like the loneliness that wraps around keeps deepening until I drown. Fond memories we used to share pierce me till I no longer care. I cannot run, I cannot hide, I cannot think. So this is probably, you know, maybe the reason why it's become so popular even worldwide, it's because it does resonate with certain moments in people's lives. Mm-hmm. But what's interesting is with the delivery of this sort of the singer, it's that it is that... it's as raw as it gets, actually.
Yeah, it's like a scream of help type of, like, delivery. It's
very uneasy.
It really is. And given the uniqueness of the voice itself, it's really taken advantage of the emotional input of the song itself. It just amplifies that pain-inducing delivery. If I didn't read the lyrics and I only heard the song, I would have gotten the agony straight away.
Because
it sounds like you're being stabbed, you know, like it's constantly being punched, being taken damage. you know, and it's raw, and you can feel the bleeding.
You know what it feels like? It feels like
shards of glass.
Yeah, but imagine it appears like here, right? And then you took it out, and it's been days, and now it's starting to heal. And then you get stabbed in the same place.
Yeah.
That's what it feels like.
It kind of does.
Fucking odd. It's like, oh god, it's like...
It's uncomfortable, yet somehow satisfying now to listen to.
My interesting thing is, obviously, it has become popular. But I'd imagine it's a mixture of, obviously, the composition and also the fact that it's part of an anime. But I think probably the relatability between the anime, right? Like, people mm-hmm, relate this mm-hmm. song to the animated series.
Yeah.
And then all the memories they've created through watching these episodes... That's the song they relate to. So it's such a smart marketing perspective here, because you're creating such a strong deep relationship between the series and the song. This is something I noticed in the Korean OSTs. They do really well as well. But here maybe it's even stronger than ever, because it's so raw. It there's no pink here. There's no sort of.
There's no line of hope at all.
No, this is a scream of help.
That's right, and. You know, based on the few animes that I have seen in my time, I think you have changes of openings, like, halfway through the season. So,
Really?
Like, say that you get to mid-season, then you change, the opening OST changes. So, the soundtrack changes, so you get a completely different, like, it's like a new sound.
Well,
to
it's changed
the new,
the tone.
Exactly, to the new tone that you're about to see in the new complications of the storyline, and I think that's very clever. That doesn't happen very often, but I like that inclusion of sound aid to complement the storytelling of the story itself.
Would it be far-fetched to say that the story of Tokyo Ghoul, it's summarized perhaps in some manner through the OST?
Could be. I usually that's the way it plays out. Lyricism goes hand in hand with the storyline of the manga.
Right? If that's true, fuck me, that's a dog anyway.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure some of you probably cried watching it.
Oh, I would think so. It sounds painful. That's all I can say. It's beautiful arrangements. Gorgeous strings. The use of the falsettos is gorgeous.
Got a little makeup on this voice. It's a class example of silence and emptiness, stillness.
It's gorgeous use of modulation too. God, what an ending! What the hell? That is a class ending.
Really good.
It is. Okay, let's talk about the technicalities of the...
Of the
vocalization here, the use of the breathiness, the use of that falsetto, and the inclusion of twang in certain places gives the absolute feeling of being showered by winter rain. You know, it's like it's painful because, like, you know, when the rain in winter is like so cold, it actually hurts your skin.
Unfortunately, yes, I do know.
Yeah, well, that's exactly what the song sounds like to me. And the is the way is the vocal modulation, because the musical arrangement is actually pretty it's pretty symphonic, so you have that inclusion of that swell up towards the end where the climax of the song is coming through. His vocal his vocal delivery didn't actually change right from the start. He was already at a point of screaming for help.
Mm-hmm.
So right off the bat, the utilization of the swell in the music actually aided the vocalist towards the climax. That's what led to the climax, not the vocals, which is usually what leads such big moments in the music. So it's really interesting, because also the vocals didn't feel very processed, very extremely touched and equalized.
At least it felt
yeah.
like that.
So it didn't feel like there was a lot of. It felt very human. It felt very very true, very broken in so many ways, and I like it.
It's interesting how you can sort of just perhaps, you know, listening and observing to different types of art from all across the world. It's very interesting how you can see how, you know, specific principles being played out to their best. I've mentioned it before in the podcast, and it's one of the biggest privileges I think that I have to be able to, you know, sort of review this type of music and share it with you guys, and even have a chance sometimes to speak to some of these guys. And it's so sort of marvelous to see so many different principles. And sometimes the sad part is that you wouldn't be exposed to this type of stuff, you know,
yeah.
unless perhaps you were willingly looking for it, or maybe you even stumbled upon it, because it's like, you know, in order to be exposed to great art, you have to go to good galleries.
Absolutely.
Or even just to go to galleries. Sometimes you find the biggest, best hidden gems in mundane moments in
mm-hmm.
galleries that perhaps are not, you know, the best or whatever. I'm not very well-versed in sort of plastic arts and anything like that.
But that's a great analogy. I totally agree. You have to somehow start somewhere. Like, you have to be open to... put your foot in the door.
Well,
basically,
this is certainly one of the best examples I have of that I would give, and that I would look to if I was trying to replicate anything, or if I was trying to introduce for example the principle that I'm talking about here, of stillness, silence, and being able to tell a story with no words, right?
Mm-hmm.
Giving silence power. And that's a very difficult thing to do in music, because especially in this world of ever evolving music, and kind of the market and mainstream dictates things sometimes, and the market, the crowd and the market sets the demand, so it has to be, you know, non-stop and always moving and entertaining, and it has to have fluctuations and ups and downs and climaxes, but there's very little time for silences and
mm-hmm.
and the stillness and to tell stories in a different tempo. So you seem to find those principles really at a really high level in different industries, and really if you expose yourself willingly to those, that's probably a good example of that. I've noticed that sometimes in, you know, some songs that we've discovered through the Filipino industry, there's also been some great pieces in the Korean industry. This
yeah.
is probably this is probably the best I've seen.
I think the usage of raw vocals with the closing of an a cappella vocalization, they provide such beautiful they're really taking advantage of the lyricism and the composition of the track itself, with the emotional intent. So yeah, I think I agree.
Anyways,
it's a pretty powerful piece right there.
The next one, it's actually in First Take.
Yeah.
And I apologize, I don't know how to pronounce this. It's called
Eir
Aoi. I don't know if they have R's in Japan. I don't think they do.
I don't like really
Eris
know. Where was the OST for? This is the...
I have it on my phone if you want.
Uh-huh. Ignite Sword, Song
Sword
written,
Art.
Smash Hit
Sword
Anime.
Art.
Sword Art Online
2.
Right, okay. Let's have a look. Ooh,
I know
lyrics.
We heard Gurenge, right? Which is Lisa's
yeah.
OST, which is very
mm-hmm.
popular.
ツアーさ回れなかったじゃないですか
Isn't that sad?
Is it because of the pandemic? Or?
I would think so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love the equalization in this room.
What?
Brother, the whole idea of what is literally in here.
Dude, what's going on in Japan, dude?
I don't really understand, but okay.
That's fucking insane.
It wasn't even the it's not even close to the rhythm. If you're thinking about song structure, okay, that makes perfect sense. Okay, opening with an a cappella, just kind of like, you know, let it ring, let it be whatever it has to be, fine, that's good. But then the piano comes in and it's like a completely different track. And what was her cue? Like, she just came out of nowhere, just...
I think, well, actually...
there.
Freedom in nothingness. So I think the pianist has... quite a bit of freedom here.
Oh yeah, definitely.
I think there's wrong time.
I'm right talking time. About from the vocal perspective. Well, so much pressure. What the?
What's impressive of her is, yeah, it's like a rocket. But actually, it's not even like a rocket. It's like a bullet. She sort of takes off.
That's right.
It's just one way, dude.
It's like a slap in the face.
There's no...
She was talking and she was halfway through her sentence and I was like, actually, there you go.
She was saying she feels when you're portraying music through a screen. You have to do with conviction.
And I agree with that.
And she says, that's what I'm going to keep in my head as I do this. Da, 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 holy
oh my
shit.
God. Well, intention achieved.
You won, mate.
You won. Fair enough. Indeed. Also, her singing phrases are so long. Like, breath control is such a pinnacle aspect of the way that she's singing. The singing phrases are so prolonged. And she breathes a lot with her tummy muscles, so it's really prominent because of the belt. You can see how it's really cool. I love that steak. This freaking show is
right.
The so, freaking golden mine of magnifying great details.
Well, actually,
I love
it. Very interesting, because later on, I think we're going to watch, I think, a group for the first time, right? So I'm very intrigued on that, what that environment sounds like in a group setting. But anyways, I think they deserve all the credit in the world and more.
Yeah, this is exciting though. This is freaking exciting.
Go on.
Quick.
So rapid. Oh, she has a cast or something.
God, there's so much happening. See how long the singing phrases are?
All of them.
Mm-hmm.
How is she not exhausted?
I have no idea. I was gonna say the
what the fuck? This dude, I'm gonna search up the BPM. Was that? I'm gonna guess that's 130, 140. I was literally just doing metronome work yesterday. Just with my father on the drums. I mean, we're just doing, I think, 110, right? And that's pretty rapid. Like, if you do jazz at 110, I mean, I guess you could do it a bit rapid. And sort of, you know, you're practicing arrangements and stuff like that. Like, it's rough. But to sing at this tempo and such long sentences and belting.
And it's not only that there's a belt, it's like she's really mixing it with a lot of twang, so it sits really high up in the larynx. It's really quite high up, but it's the constant hit of the notes. There's no break. She really doesn't have
what
like a breather.
What the fuck is 171?
Oh my god, that's freaking quick.
That's so rapid.
Play it. Play the. It's quicker.
I think they're playing it slower.
I think they are.
Because that's not 170, no way. Go on. Press play. It's the same.
Is it the same?
More or the less.
God, there's just no break. So quick. I don't think it's a cast, bro. I think it's like a accessory.
Really?
Yeah. It's like leathery.
She doesn't move her wrist. Yeah, that's a fatiguing sentence.
God, that's so hard.
Oh my god.
What the hell was that, senora?
Please
that was
rest.
Crazy nuts.
Oh my god, what the
come
fuck?
On, chill.
So yeah, thanks mate. Thanks for coming to my show.
That's all I have to say. Thank you. What?
And she looks like she's so like, actually, like, oh, thanks
like,
so much.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
What?
It's like, this was a humbling experience. What? Excuse me. That was ridiculous. Like, no, it was way faster. It's so demanding. There's like
the key?
Constant freaking up there all the time. That chorus doesn't give you a break.
People give a rating of like popularity, energy, danceability, happiness,
okay.
Acousticness. Popularity is like whatever. Okay. 29 out of I don't know fucking 1,000. And then energy, 97 out of 100.
Ah, 97. It's like super like, it's like marching band.
Yeah, do you want to guess the key?
I don't know.
A minor.
I was going to say.
You want to say F, right?
No, I was going to... well, yeah, sure.
That's what I thought.
A minor.
A minor. That's fucking large, bro.
But A what? That's like an...
I just says A minor.
That is nuts. I don't even know how she did that. And she sounds exactly the same in freaking... The original, like the that is nuts. What type of mixing are they getting these people? They really not mixing those vocals at all. It's like, sing, do what you do.
It's interesting. There's no sign. There wasn't, I mean, I would imagine if you ask her after that number, maybe, you know, what the fuck would you sing after this? Or do you not even put this in your set when you're performing?
Oh, but this is some of the most popular, so you would have to put this in your
Where
set.
Where would you place it? Ah, it's so worrying. Like
it is nuts.
That is madness. I'm very intrigued by the Japanese music industry.
Me too.
Probably one of the most intriguing, because the pedigree is so high. If not one of the highest, if not the highest music pedigree, we have experienced.
Intellectually speaking, it's so intelligent compositions.
On the podcast, I can't think of any other sort of compositions that we've seen that are consistently this complex. And that also, they're also very fucking popular.
Uh-huh.
That's not normal.
That isn't normal at all.
It's very abnormal, actually.
Wow, I'm totally blown away, but, you know, making my case here, it's nuts.
And I keep reading the comments. So I keep going back to the Japan podcast that we did like 2 weeks mm-hmm. ago and keep reading the comments. Because, I proposed a lot of questions there, and thank you so much for taking the time for answering them, guys. Like, it's unbelievable. And I'm reading sort of, you know, what historically sort of music has been like in Japan, and mm-hmm. also what the education system and sort of academia system of music is. And it does seem to be very profound. It seems to be probably one of the most...
Yeah, it made sense to me. Like, academically speaking, one of the most...
refined systems.
Indeed. And it's something that is inculcated really early on in the community, in the people. So yeah, it's just intelligent music delivery. It's common knowledge to know, you know, how to read a score. And it's common knowledge to understand complex diversity in music.
I don't know, it certainly seems so, right?
Well, yeah, and that's pretty nuts. Anyways,
at least what I've been reading is perhaps it's not like that. Like everyone sort of just
no, but it's I said it's common knowledge. It's not like everybody does it.
Right.
But it's common.
But what people are telling me in the comments and sending me as messages, it's more like in order to make it to that level.
Oh yeah, you have to go through.
It's not perhaps in other sort of parts of the world where perhaps it's more sort of a what you call it popularity is very important.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe even paramount mm-hmm. there, I think, depending on the genre you decide to go
Academia
for.
Academia is paramount before popularity, I suppose.
And also perceived skill in the industry.
See.
That's what it seems to be more like.
You know, oh,
like
how well regarded
and respected. Like respect in the music industry is ginormous.
That's wonderful. I like
Again,
that
I'm
approach.
Only just paraphrasing some of these comments. I do apologize if perhaps I'm, you know, a bit misguided. Bit yeah. of a misguided soul.
Hey, indeed. I mean, now this is exciting because now we're getting
is that Bluebird?
Too much. This is Bluebird from Naruto, and yeah, it's an iconic song. I think everybody knows this.
So, Bluebird by Ikimonogakari. Ikimonogakari.
Fair enough.
Yeah, this is the Naruto OST.
This is the official music video. I've never seen it either. I know some of the songs because of like the 1 minute cut.
This is how far I got into Naruto before I was like, wow, I'm when is this gonna end?
Wow, yeah.
Can I have my freedom back? Cartoon Network. I watched it in Cartoon Network.
Did you?
Yeah, when they were playing.
Was it in Nickelodeon though?
No, Cartoon. Yeah, Cartoon Network. Mm. When it was in Cartoon, like 2007, 2008, around that time.
Oh, wow, okay.
And I watched it for a few good years because they kept playing it on. And never got to the end. Like, I never saw... Is it Sasuke in Spanish? I don't know. Well, they'll be the same names, right?
I suppose, yeah.
I can't even remember the names.
You want me to... Let's search it up.
The girl is... Can't remember the pink girl. Then Sasuke. And... Ah, fuck.
Okay, Naruto.
My favorite character was Gaara. My favorite fight scene is Gaara and Lee.
Characters.
He has like weights in his ankles.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I never actually got into Naruto at all. I couldn't.
And that's where I stopped watching during the tournament.
Sasuke. Itachi.
Who's Itachi?
The guy with the bandana at the top, like here.
He's like the teacher. He's like the captain. Yeah. What's the girl? Sakura. And then, yeah, Naruto. Kakashi. He was everyone's favorite in my school. Because he's like Mr. Cool Guy.
Yeah.
But he's actually powerful as shit. But yeah, I like Gaara, I remember him very well. What's the other guy? Rock Lee, that's it. And Rock Lee, he fights Gaara. And then he finally takes off the weights.
Oh,
and then that fight scene is awesome. And
there's a hell of a ton of like,
dude.
Characters, golly guacamole.
Dude, it's insane, and they have like 15 seasons. It's ridiculous.
Wow, let's see how many episodes. Let's see how many episodes. Thousands.
I think it's on the thousands.
I think it has. Holy crap. 21 seasons.
Yeah.
21 freaking seasons, and each season has 21 episodes.
So how many? So it's like 200 episodes.
I suppose, do the math. I don't know.
Fuck.
That's actually pretty freaking nuts.
It's large. It felt like thousands to me, anyways.
Well, it's large.
It's big.
It's large.
But also, like they then sort of like a bit of mythology gets involved. And he's like an animal, right? He's like the tail fox thing.
Oh, that's like what a gumiho.
I don't know if I said. Well, I didn't know. I wouldn't know because back then I didn't know what a gumiho was.
That's true, but I'm just saying. Is it a gumiho? Is it like a nine fox tail?
I think that's what it is. Yeah, and then Sasuke, he's basically like a demon or something. Like, he's fucking crazy.
Cool. I never got into Naruto, but obviously it was so popular, everybody was into Naruto.
Dragon Balls is also an anime, right?
Dragon Ball Seed.
Yeah, Dragon Ball Z.
Yeah, it is.
I watched like the first season of that.
Sakura Card Captor. That was also an anime.
Yeah.
I was literally into it. From children to us until I got to like 14 years old.
What the hell was that movie? That fucked up movie you made me watch?
Spirited Away.
Oh my god, it was a pig. And then there's those things. Like, you like that? Oh, you gave me nightmares.
Yeah, I think I traumatized you with that movie. But
pushed me away from animes.
And then there was also all the Studio Ghibli Studios animes. They were the best.
There's also a goat video.
Not a goat. There was a dragon.
No, it was a goat. It was a different anime. She's like a little girl, and she lives in the mountains. She has this little goat. Just this goat.
Abuelito, dime tú.
Yeah, her.
What is the name of
No idea.
In English, I don't actually know.
I don't know, but she would live like in the mountains. And I don't even know what the plot was.
Haiti.
Was it?
Haiti.
Yeah, she would live in the mountains. I don't even know what she would do. She just live there.
Abuelito, dime tú. I don't actually know the name of that freaking anime.
I don't think anyone knows the plot either.
It's about this girl that lived in the mountains, in like the Alps or something.
And there was a goat.
Yeah, she had a goat as a pet. It was actually a very sad anime. I only realized.
Was it sad? Does their grandpa die? Spoiler alert. Actually, I think it's like 50,000 years old.
No, she's like an orphan. And like this old man takes her in. But she's like abandoned or something. It's like a really sad anime.
Or is it a movie?
No, it's like a whole series. Yeah.
Let us know, what is your first memory of an anime that you have? I think the first memory of an anime I have, is either that or that shit movie Bella showed me.
Oh, Spirited Away. That's a fantastic movie. I still watch it to this day. It's a great movie.
Tormented fucking writer that was.
It's not that
What
bad.
A monster he was.
It's like Alice in Wonderland.
No, it's a movie for kids. And it's a tormented movie.
Well, Alice in Wonderland isn't pretty either.
I had to take a few years, bro. Anyways, back to narrative.
I think my first... memory of an anime. It's probably Pokemon.
Probably mine too. I would say so, yeah.
Because I was like in first grade or something.
Either Pokemon, Digimon, or Yu-Gi-Oh.
I think there were... No, Yu-Gi-Oh came way later.
Oh, no. Beyblades.
Beyblades. Oh my god, and everybody used to have trompos, playing their trompos.
Well, I was part of the upper echelon in Moscow because I had the fucking Beyblades.
Oh, you had the actual Beyblades.
And I even had the fucking battleground and everything.
Oh my god.
Dude, I was a fucking...
You spoiled little brat.
Yeah, dog, that's when you get when you're the young sibling.
Absolutely.
But also...
I'm the only boy, so...
Actually, that's not true at all. Back then, I was gigging so much. I was earning, mate. Buying toys.
Come on.
And I was like six.
Okay, moving on. So this is Naruto's OST.
Touring like a motherfucker, buying Beyblades. And phones, even though I didn't know. I had a phone so early on, I only realized that now. Dude, I was a pimp. Go on. Wearing Gucci, mink.
See, I know the song. It's a freaking banger, I tell you, it's a banger. Memory time. It's a great song, but I remember listening to now that I think about it, I remember listening to the song on my friend's MP3.
Really?
Yes, on in school, like the breaks, you know, or you would like send the MP3s on like trees on like infrared signals. You remember that? Yeah. You would have to like pair up your phone real quick to another like.
Do you guys remember that?
Like, and Bluetooth, what was Bluetooth for?
Bluetooth.
What was that for?
It was the shittier version of infrared.
Oh, because infrared was quicker, wasn't it?
Way faster, and also every phone sort of had it.
Like, they had, I don't know if you guys remember, but it's like, they had like a little black patch. Yeah.
Data transfer through that.
Uh-huh, that was so weird.
Wi-Fi wasn't a thing yet.
Oh, no, not at all.
Not as big as it was, anyways.
No.
Maybe big corporations were using it. Bluetooth.
But not on your phones. Like, I don't remember having phones that had... But I remember the MP3s, like, the little tiny, like, they were literally a play button, pause button, next and before.
I won one in a contest, you remember?
Oh, No.
Well, I won several, actually. I was very lucky.
Yeah, I suppose.
I had a dope childhood, dude.
Yeah.
Fucking winning contests out there and shit. Cheetos contest, you remember? Fucking, I bought so many bags of Cheetos.
That's actually
But then
so
I got
true.
An iPod Nano.
You did?
Yeah, and it was basically, it looked like the weirdest thing ever. It was just
a rod. It was like a pen drive.
It was a rod. It was a little rod.
But like this big as well.
No buttons, no nothing. Just a little aux cord.
And it was the first time that they were integrating the headphones that were interactive.
They had commands. Like if you press two times, it goes forward. If you press three times, it goes back to the next, to the previous song. The back bottom.
That's true. What year was that? Like 2008?
Yeah, probably about 2008. Yeah.
Probably, right?
That's in an 87, something like that.
I was like in
Your mate, she always had the dopest shit. She had, when we had an iPod Nano, she had an iPod Touch.
Oh, yeah.
That had the little wheel thing.
Oh, yeah. The
And it would have the funniest videos. It would have, do you remember that polar bear video?
Yes, that's true.
We'd have happy three friends, all that type of shit. It was hilarious, and yeah, that's when we.
That's where I first heard this music. This whole song. Now that I remember, wow, memory lane. There, that's some information for you.
Yeah, dude.
You can see the cameraman.
Good video. Never seen this. Nice.
It's such a musically well-made song.
Tight.
When did this come out?
2020, look.
No, this was posted in 2020.
2008.
This makes sense.
You know what I was going to ask? How does this happen? Do you sort of... Did they ask them to specifically make...
Yeah.
Because apparently from what in the community post, we usually post, you know, for you guys to request stuff like that. And then we also do the research and regarding what it's going to do. Like what's going to go on the podcast, sorry. So one of the things people were saying is like, I want to say the name of the band, but Ikimonogakari was a very well respected band,
mm-hmm.
even previous to that.
Mm-hmm.
Young,
mm-hmm.
new, but still
respected.
Yeah, and but this is obviously one of the most successful things that they probably did. But so how does this come along? Like, is it the same as like in you know how like sometimes K-pop bands they get like, oh, would you like to?
Absolutely.
Or like, you know, just artists like IU is like.
Most of the times that's what happens. So say for example the animation company that provides an idea concept and then they search up whoever is the most suited for
to portray
for,
the message
for the concept of the manga itself. The sometimes labels actually offer certain groups, certain bands, certain singers we have them, they would be great for this and this and that. But I think sometimes, most of the times, is what is required from the animation or the storyline.
Do you remember, like, in South America, obviously, novelas are very, that's like our version of, like, animes, I guess.
Basically.
Or they're, at least at their popularity level. And what they would do is, very early on, instead of choosing an artist that was famous, they choose someone who no one knew about.
That's right, and they will become famous because of these tracks.
Like,
yeah.
Good example of that would be like
Jesse Joy,
right?
Yeah.
Jesse and Joy.
No, well, Jesse Joy is the name of the band.
It's two people. They're brothers.
They're siblings. Yeah.
Oh, siblings.
Yeah, because she's a girl and he's a boy. Yeah.
Siblings. Yes. So you get people like, oh, what song is that? You know, someone else who did that really well lately has been Lucifer.
Oh yeah.
First season of Lucifer. If you look at the credits of all the songs that they play, you probably wouldn't recognize many names.
Well, you know who used to do that a lot? MTV, when they start including a TV series into their network.
Right.
They would feature a lot of new artists into their TV series, like, and they would add a little footnote whenever a song was playing. This is band and whatever, listen to MTV, whatever, blah 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 blah.
Nice.
So yeah, so it is one of those things. But I think at this level of iconic, I would think telenovelas in South America do this or used to do this.
So maybe in Japan, let us know if that's sometimes the case where they sort of give a chance to sort of like a new band or someone that they sort of think would do well, but it's not very popular yet.
Yeah. It would be cool though. I think, yeah, it works. It's a great video, isn't it? They're in the cage, they're the birds, I like that.
They're all fairly rapid songs. It's an intro, right?
Yeah. You only get the 1 minute. How beautiful.
Oh, he was crying.
She's gorgeous as well, what the hell?
Looks younger. Nice.
Freaking bravo. How cool, I wonder what they're doing now.
Aoi, aoi, dun, 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 dun. I don't know what they're doing now, actually. But imagine they're very active.
Still I'm telling you, what a freaking banger of a track.
Still getting requested to play that song, I would imagine.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And also, you know, the writers of Naruto, did it come from a manga? You know?
Yeah. It's a manga's first, usually.
Always. Most of the time.
So they know how
successfully it was.
Here I am spitting a knowledge. I don't actually know, but I most of the mangas I saw.
Most of the animes you've seen.
Yeah, it came from mangas first.
And then
popular mangas that they got animated.
And then perhaps they can take a bit more liberty in funding and budgets because they have some sort of evidence to provide to funders and investors.
For example, I think some of the ones I saw, like Death Note and stuff, like they were already very popular as a manga series.
Those are incredibly popular.
Very popular, but when they got animated as a proper anime, the stock value went even higher.
That's a movie as well, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah. Crappy movie.
Death Book or Death Note?
Death Note. it didn't even come close to doing it justice. That really? Manga is so cool.
I saw the video.
So is Bleach. I freaking loved Bleach as an anime, but when I watched the movie, the real life version, like the, you know, with humans, yeah. I was like, it's good, but it's not good enough. You know,
there was a movie.
It was kind of sad.
There was a movie that was fully in Japan that I watched in this YouTube channel on how to survive this like specific movie, like a horror movie. That and how, what would be your best, your you know, like if you were in that position in that surreal world, what would be the best to do? And it's a very funny video to watch. It's hilarious. And it's also, but he actually
how
tries.
How to survive.
Death Note.
Ah, nice.
Like that. Or okay, how to survive, I don't know, World War Z. Oh. That type of shit. How to survive The Last of Us. But it's usually animes he does.
Well, what was that? What was the stupid Titan one? Like, not stupid. I didn't mean to say stupid. I just never got into it. The Titan, well, like, yeah, it's very popular.
What is it?
I don't know. It's about these people that when they bleed, they become giants and like it's.
Well, that does sound fucking stupid.
No, Efra, it's like not.
Attack on Titan.
That's the one.
They don't bleed, you big fucking melon. I've seen that. You put some respect on that shit. Actually, that's the only anime I've actually completed.
There it is.
Yeah.
You've actually seen it.
How dare you? They don't bleed.
I never got into it. I didn't like the idea.
If you get bitten.
Like zombies.
Well, actually. Oh, it's a bit complex, mate.
I know. I bet.
I even. Oh, actually, I didn't finish the Attack on Titan. I only saw season one and then I played the video game.
Oh, what?
Yeah, I played the video game. Very good game. It's awesome. The traversal. Oh, class. Very fun.
Awesome. Okay. Well, that's that. I didn't understand.
They attempted to make a lot of Attack on Titan games on PC. They're mostly shit. And then this one that I played came out because I saw Jacksepticeye play it.
Ah, right.
This was during my younger years.
I see.
When I was still in school.
Well, you can see the generational difference because you carried on to watch like that generation of animes.
What were you saying about Attack on Titan?
I didn't like it at all.
Wow.
My bad. Sorry for anyone out there. I didn't like it at all.
It's a bit, you know what? It's a bit gruesome in a weird way. It's odd. And also the Titans are just like smiling.
I know. It's freaking weird. It freaked me out.
But they have balls. They're not afraid to kill people.
I know. And I hate that.
I love that.
I love when people are nice and polite.
No.
It's like, you like this person. We might keep him.
Give me realism.
What the fuck?
Give me realism. I don't want to escape my reality. I want to feel something.
No, how is Attack on Titans anyway realistic into any way of life?
Well, you don't know. You didn't see Corona coming.
Well, that's a very perfectly great point. Moving on.
You know, just saying.
We have two more by together here.
This TXT, is TXT. What the fuck?
And they are on the studios of First Take.
Love
and
that.
They're going to be singing Force, which is the soundtrack for, I love that they have all the information in the description box. I love that. It's for, this is from their Japan first album, their Japanese first album, Still Dreaming.
Force.
With, has a hit number one on Oricon, National Weekly Album Rating.
World Trigger, second season.
Ah, right.
World Trigger, second season.
Okay,
and the
cool.
song was written by Motoki Omori from Miss Green Apple.
That's another thing that I would like to highlight. Don't Japanese names are like sound the coolest?
Some of them, yeah.
Like they sound the coolest. Maybe I've been conditioned by my childhood ideas.
Some of them literally sound like they were born to be heroes.
Basically, how cool are you? Like the world has no chance of coolness, none.
Yeah, come on. I love this. The first time we're going to watch any of these lads in such an exposing environment.
No, how exciting.
Difficult environment to perform.
Like, everybody make noise now.
Samuine.
Samuine.
Chuo?
Are you
good? Yeah.
Chuo?
Nado.
Nado.
Hai.
Chuo suo mita.
Yeah, they're speaking in Korean, bro.
Chuo suo mita. That means I'm okay, I'm cool. And then kwanchanayo means fuck off, I'm okay.
No. It just means also you're okay too.
I want to learn the bit. I want to learn a swear word. Like, just in case. I mean, you know, walking around Korea and then someone wants to give me a leaflet. It's like, please come try our noodles. Kwanchanayo. Piss off.
Yeah, but you don't.
Because you might get bombarded by them. I don't know. They might think I'm a tourist.
Because you do.
Well, because I am a tourist. Be dressed there, but okay. I love Korea.
Seoul 101.
Seoul hot.
Just walking. First time in Korea.
Just walking. Bubble tea. Another bubble tea here. A bag that says, I love Korea. But I love Korea more in the back.
And like a bunch of like face masks.
Yeah, and they might try and rip me off, you know, on the street, like a street vendor or something.
Okay, can we watch?
Yeah, yeah, sorry, just saying.
No problem.
Can you please someone teach me swear words in Korean? Oh, Subin, yeah.
Subin.
It's the second time recording there.
저는
딸이에요. 딸이에요.
그런 아직까지.
Aren't they freaking cute?
저는 추워서 떨려요.
Fairly young as well, right?
턱이 떨려도 떴는데. 네, 뭐 그렇습니다. 아까보다 훨씬 괜찮은데.
네, 그래도 잘할 수 있을 것 같습니다.
맞아요.
또 이제 Force가 World Trigger OST랑
World Trigger
좀 좋더라고요.
좋아졌으면 좋겠습니다.
네, 네.
아, cute.
좋습니다.
준비됐나요?
네, 준비됐습니다.
Wow, that's so nice.
I
think let's go.
Let's go.
Bring
yeah.
Yeah,
yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. They are cool.
Take it.
Damn, what the freak?
Didn't see that color.
Me neither.
We are dreamers, so it's a trigger. She pulls, she dies. Must keep you down, down, down. For the light is in the air. For the light is in the air.
Alright.
Whoa. That's a lot to unpack in like a minute.
The chord progressions are nuts. What is it about? Yeah, it's pedigree of music intricacy. Because otherwise,
it's specifically made, right? For sort of, you know, the Japan fans and so.
Absolutely, it is basically just for that. And I think what is interesting though is that there's always high energy packed, like high tempo, strong drumming to it, and it's yeah the chord progressions are intricate and unpredictable. They're all over the place. In comparison to what I have been exposed to my whole life, this is incredibly complex. And do you think that this is the music, yeah, that gets popularized and everybody
Madness.
Goes to listen to and it sings along to? It's actually pretty mind-boggling.
I'm intrigued.
To me.
I want
to
see a song evolve.
That also, I just want to say that the rhythmicality of the singing phrases are actually quite intricate too, so they have to be really on top of their game when
yep.
it comes to timing.
I would be nervous.
I would be nervous too.
But also, don't be nervous, because you need to be on point.
Because you also need to be relaxed.
Yeah, be chill, bro.
And if you're nervous, you're not relaxed.
And it's really, you know, obviously very first take, the way they sort of equalize in this, where the vocals on top really,
yeah.
really emphasized, and then the backing track. They do have layers on, you know, to provide a bit of thickness, especially
I think
because
it comes from the track.
No, that's what I mean. They do have layers on the track, like,
yeah.
Just layers of the same phrases that they're singing. To provide that, maybe, yeah, perhaps a more...
Depth, it's just to provide depth.
Thick sound, depth,
yeah.
you know, deep
But it's
sound.
Really not aiding their singing
whatsoever.
No, but
it's mixed. That's so rough.
It sounds like one of those demos that you get before you go into the studio, before you do the actual takes that get a ton
of post-production. Oh my God, you're right, yeah, yeah. That's bang on.
Yeah.
What the fuck?
Down, down, we are pleaded. So it's a trigger.
See, even the entries are so intricate. Sorry, can I go back?
His progression.
Yeah, that was crazy. I love his vocals, it's so cool.
He's very good.
Yeah. What is this track?
Nice work by Subin. Take him on that. Unreal. Got such a difficult section.
Yeah. I love his hand gestures, they're great.
Oh my god, I'm so stressed.
Are you crazy?
That is so stressful.
And I love how they just stand there, just like, yeah, we did that. What now?
Those are the pieces that you want to run away from, because
they are so complicated.
That is so stressful. As a singer, as a musician, everything, it feels like a song goes on forever.
The production is really freaking nuts, though. I like the changes in the production, in the beat dynamics of it. It's really nice.
Yeah, I mean, you know what's interesting? What I'm noticing, right, with this sort of, like, OSTs for animes, is, like, I don't know. Like, for example, that song, I don't know how much I'm going to repeat that song, right? Because I put myself in those shoes as performing it.
Yeah.
And I find that stressful.
Yes.
I would be sweating buckets if I'm drumming to that. Or if I'm doing anything regarding in that song.
Yeah.
And I don't know how they maintain such calm and ease through it. Obviously, rehearsals and happy days. They're also a very talented bunch. And this confirms my theory about them. Because I seem to have an affinity with their tracks.
Yeah.
TXT. Is either TXT or in Hypen, which I'm very... like in this new sort of new generation-esque, TXT a bit older than Hypen, and Hypen are basically babies, right?
But they're so great.
But it's kind of new generation. Yeah. I seem to have more of an affinity with those group, perhaps more than any other groups that are young. And I like their OSTs. Essentially, I think I like more of the OSTs. Those are the ones that I always find myself repeating, TXTs.
Yeah.
But that one, dude, oh my god. I'd be like, please let the lads breathe.
Well, I've seen it from a vocal perspective. The dynamics and the jumps and the complete unpredictability of the track, kinda it works in sections. So, and the sections repeat themselves. They kinda come back often.
Yeah, that's true.
Now that's what I've been able to depict so far in all the songs that we've seen in this podcast. We've had they're musically intricate and incredibly dynamic, and their chord progressions are really unpredictable, but they kind of repeat themselves in sections. So you have...
At least three times they end up repeating themselves.
So you have a you have to your advantage the accommodation of the ear. So
yeah,
you
yeah.
kind of like accommodate, acclimate to the changes as the song progresses. But because of the in-between sections, between the repetition of the first, say, A sections,
so yep.
before the B section. So you have the B sections being so incredibly completely different to what we had been exposed previously, that when the A section comes back in, that you have you feel like you've been in a complete roller coaster of sound, as well as of emotion, of course. But they're really high intensity, they're really high, they demand a lot of like energy from the performers, from a musical perspective, as from a singing perspective too. I mean, First Take is a vocal focus.
Yep.
But yeah, it's a difficult piece, but it's really cool to see it in TXT's case, for example, because they kind of they've laid out the sections of the work really well between the five of
workload,
them.
Workload, yeah.
Yeah, the workload has been really well spread out. So you have those sections. So as a group, you're learning sections, not a song, and that's easier to approach it. Like,
well,
that's how I see it.
It's very.
It's a long track as well. It's like 4 minutes and a half.
It became, you know, more and more obvious. That's it. So, like, Taehyun had very difficult sections, but Yeonjun, he had incredibly well. He was holding
He was carrying the tune. Yeah.
Subin had very nice sort of melodies and harmonies sections, but
then
essentially,
again, they were working in sections. Each person, each member had a section of the song. So when you come together, it's more like piecing a puzzle together rather than having to learn a whole piece.
Oh, look.
It makes sense.
I was going to ask, when he said his name, Hyunin, apologies, Kai, that's his first name, Kai. He's from Hawaii.
He's from Hawaii?
Yeah.
How
yeah.
cool!
Yeah.
Nice.
I thought he was going to say he was actually Japanese.
Yeah.
But yeah, so he speaks English.
Coolness. I like that.
That's awesome.
They're a great group, though.
And they're all a bit younger than me. They're all 20, about 19, 20, 21.
Mm-hmm.
Very impressive work for the lads. From
indeed.
The lads, anyway.
And I think to finish it off, we have yet another K-pop group in the First Take as well. This is Stray Kids.
Ooh.
And their OST Japanese version for SLUMP, which...
Oh right, yeah, SLUMP, yeah.
Which I'm about to find out what it was for, but
I'll tell you.
It's lagging a little bit.
So SLUMP is Tower of God.
Oh, Tower of God. All right, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, Tower of God, and yeah, it's the Japanese theme.
Before we look into this, can you please look at like a picture of what TXT's was?
Oh yeah,
Clover.
Sure.
Sorry, no, World Trigger. This is the one we watched, season 2.
I wanted to watch Black Clover, because
there's also Treasure did a bit for Black
Crunchy
Clover.
Crunchyroll. I'm obsessed right now. But yeah, no.
But you've seen it.
No, I haven't seen Black Clover. It's what's the name?
World Trigger.
World.
Season 2.
Trigger. Trigger.
Season 2.
Let's see.
Just do this, hold on, mate.
Oh, yep.
Let's have a look at, like, images.
Images.
I think
anytime?
I haven't clicked it.
Okay, anytime now? Oh, nice.
This one doesn't seem as dark.
No, it
seems darkish, but not as dark.
But it has a darkish edge to it.
You know what's also weird?
Mystical?
You never know the age of them.
That's actually a great point.
You know, it's like sometimes you think it's a child and it turns out it's like 17.
That's
but
cool.
But you thought it was 9 years old. Like, how old is this character?
I have no idea.
But it looks like she's 9.
Well, that's actually a very good point.
But it turns out she's lived on Earth for thousands of years.
That is accurate, brother.
I see.
I don't actually
know. You know the one I want to watch? The first one we watched. Tokyo Ghoul.
Oh, that looks so dark.
Fuck. Yeah, I want to watch the trailer, but at least.
We can search it up in Crunchyroll. I am subscribed now. I pay to watch animes now.
Yeah, that's good.
Anyway, so yeah. Because
before, you could get them on TV.
Yeah, but now you don't.
Well, actually, you probably still can, right? But it's just the ads, bro.
Well, that's why I started paying on Crunchyroll, because I started getting ads, and I was like, what the... What? I haven't seen an ad in, like, 10 years.
Yeah, I was trying to watch Rick and Morty on Channel 4.
Rick and Morty.
Season 5.
Rick and Morty.
Season 5 or Season 4, whichever the latest one is, in Channel 4, which is, okay, like, a channel here in the UK. And you have to watch it on catch-up, so you have to download the app, sign up, and all this stuff, and I wasn't a member before. But you don't have to pay. It's free.
Okay.
The reason why it's free, though, is because you only get the previous 2 weeks of episodes.
Ah, right.
And it's one per week. But they just did the finale. So I literally can only watch episode 10 or episode 9 of Rick and Morty. You see what I mean? Because it literally just finished last week.
Ah, right. So you have to wait a week for the
episode. No, I have to wait 2022 for it to go on Netflix. Yeah.
Well, that sucks.
That's tough.
You can't see the season like from the beginning of the season.
Not on Channel 4, no. Oh. Maybe there are other platforms in which you can, but not the ones that I like. Amazon Prime, no. Netflix, no.
Right.
I haven't done my due research. Maybe someone could help me.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Okay, nice. All right.
But yeah, but what I was saying, Channel 4, you get fucking ads every time. Oh, yeah. Is it you're watching TV on your phone?
Because you are.
Yeah, I don't want to do that. What are you doing? I pay for YouTube. I pay for everything, bro. Like, I'm not a big fan of, like, ads that I don't care much about. If they're ads that I care about...
Watch.
Or, like, I mean, maybe because we have a podcast and stuff, but, like, if someone like my favorite YouTubers have, like, an ad for, like, I don't know, Manscaped, whatever they
it's
always
like, put I've out, always watched them,
like,
though.
It's fucking funny. I love them.
Because it's, like, you're also not out of, like, the realm of like... You're not out of the vibe, if you know what I'm saying. Like, I think, like, a lot of the times you, like, when you watch the ads, when the ads come in, like, say you're watching, you know, your anime, your super intense moment, like, and it's like an anime about
chopping onions or some shit.
I don't know, some game on PS like whatever, and about. I don't understand what the hell is the game about, and... Yeah. And I'm like, bro, you just took me out of the mood. I was so into this scene.
No, and also, I feel like I also have a role to play. Like, it's like, oh, you know, this creator sort of doing this.
Of course.
And then I could actually help him.
That's true.
But if I fucking buy this game from Battlefield, they don't fucking care who I am. They probably release the game unfinished anyways. You know what I mean? And then they're going to patch it up later. Dickheads. Anyways, that's why I stopped playing. I'm disappointed by the gaming industry. Anyways, go on.
Oh my god, well, that's a rant.
Yeah, that's why I sold all my shit, don't put it collecting dust over. Fuck you.
Right, so this is Stray Kids Slump on First Take. I'm excited to see them because I think they're awesome. Why did it reduce the quality, senor? What happened?
Put it in 4K. Yeah, put it in 4K. I want to see what First Take looks like in 4K.
그러니까 와 누가 원테이크 다 같이 해놓고 원테이크 oh my god relatable friend
oh I take off the captions because I think first thing I also want to say I think they have the best comeback of the year so far.
Yes they do, they
and
do.
And
agree.
We've had good ones.
I agree
but I think as a band they have the best one so far.
Yes
solo hard to say because I think they all took it. On the male side, I think probably Lisa has taken the female one so far.
Mm-hmm.
But I just wish it was out. Anyways, that's a conversation for another day.
I love that everybody gets their own mixer. They can mix however they want it to. That is so cool. Finish. I wish our whole recording finished in one take.
One take. This pressure. Is a real condenser mic, yeah, bro. Never been anywhere like this. This is the first time.
It's a huge recording booth. I'm nervous.
Okay. Nice. That's nice.
Hi, say no.
Seba,
Pokatachua,
Stray Kids.
Hello, hello.
Hi, Stray Kids no leader, Bang Chan des.
Bang Chan des.
Hi, Sansa no Rino des.
Taku Rampa no Changbin des.
Changbin.
Benjin des.
Yoroshiku onegaishimas, minasan, Han des.
Oh my god.
Yes.
Damn, got it.
Sungin des.
Seiko, Ayen des.
Okay.
So supportive, which are
okay. Okay. Bang Chang is so hot. He's so hot. Oh my god.
Okay.
Yes, and the freaking. Yeah, let's go.
Live.
He goes nothing. Come on.
Hi.
Nervous for him.
Ooh, me too. I can feel the pressure. The outfits are absolutely insane, though. I love that. It's so hot.
Where you going?
Okay, so if anyone ever had a doubt, like if anyone ever thought that is freaking blah blah blah, blah. No, well, take this.
Motherfucker sounds like that for real.
Take this.
His
take
voice, because his speaking voice is a bit different.
Yeah, his speaking voice is like a normal guy his age.
Whoa, that is so impressive. Also, now
he
I understand.
He really did go through a different type of puberty, yeah, bro. Like,
he got slapped. He got not KO'd.
No.
Got abused by bro.
The bullet train fucking hit him.
I think also, now I understand why he was so nervous. He's opening.
Oh, yes.
That's why he was like, woof, woof.
It's me.
Yeah, love it. Love the guy, bro. I love these guys.
He's so adorable. Okay, I think Stray Kids is like one of my favorite groups.
I want, you know, and I want to be critical. I genuinely do because I like him a lot, and I think I'm probably more critical of the guys I enjoy the most.
Yeah, I agree. I think you're kind of harsh.
It's just a burden, you know. It's a
with
burden
with the people that you really actually admire.
Yeah,
yeah.
So yeah, but this is fucking.
This is great. I love it. Keep singing, Felix. That's hard to do. Hitori walking on the way.
That's also one of the reasons why I like them the most. I think they have some of the strongest rap lines. I also want to say, the rappers, so what you're listening there, if you are noticing sort of, oh, wow, why is the equalization different when the rappers come in? Because they are being mixed differently. The rappers do have completely different equalizations to the singers.
Yeah. Now, but they also sing, so they're working on this weird double-edged situation.
But I don't think their mixing is changing or their equalization is changing. I think what's happening is Each equalization is individualistic there, so the rappers are given this sort of like flanger type of sound,
it
right?
Is.
Metallic type of sound, because the rap, one of the things you realize, it raps in this environment are usually shit, doesn't sound cool, and especially here where it's like a cinematic type of feel, you know, it's an OST. So you're noticing that, but then it seems they're also doing these sort of falsetto lines, right?
Yeah.
So if that plays to their advantage, it's sort of rapping line, but the other singers don't have that commodity, it seems. Because this does aid performance a lot, and it does take a pressure off of you if you're singing this sort of falsetto line, because you have an effect on.
Yeah.
But the other sort of members don't seem to have this luxury. But still, saw that seamless transition there.
There are very difficult lines, though, because they're monotone lines. They're stagnant singing lines, so they're repetitive, and they don't change. So you get the first three words, or the first four words and the phrase, are a repetition of the same note, regardless of the inflection of the word itself, which is really difficult to maintain. And given the fact that you're bouncing off of other singer before you come in, it's there is a really defined pressure there that it's it's way harder than people would expect it to be. I think this is pretty impressive.
I don't know what the rules of first take are. Like, I don't know how sort of like if there is post, if there is no post, if there is that sort of part of the show. You come here, there's not gonna be any post, regardless of, you know, who you are, whatever. I don't know what the rules are. I know obviously the two rules are first take, and obviously first recording. And it's just one recording, so...
I read about this online. But it sounds
pretty clean, which is so impressive. I don't...
I read about this online. So what they do is that they come in, and if it's a soloist, like we've seen before, they mix their own vocals. That's why the mixers are there for.
Yeah, but none of them are mixing anything.
No, but they can choose how before they start the take.
Of course.
Like in speaking voices or whatever, they can mix... however the levels they wanted and whatever effects they want to put into their own voices is the artist's choice.
Are they allowed to do maybe like a few test runs?
No, there's no test runs. So there's like sound tests.
Sound check, yeah.
Sound checks, but there's no like, the first take is the take that you see. Awesome. And there's no post-production in this audio.
So whatever I would imagine
happened
maybe...
in the studio was what goes out.
Okay, so I would imagine for maybe, it's like, you know, like we saw before, TXT or Stray Kids... even, you know, someone like Lisa as well, this sort of magnitude, I would imagine it's probably not them mixing that. It's
absolutely.
Someone comes in, before they come in, they have a chat, see what's up.
Absolutely.
Let's make sure sort of those highs are high, we'll leave those lows as it is, we'll put a bit of reverb here, we'll put a bit of this and that.
That's
make
right.
sure we'll put this effect on delay just so it comes in towards the end.
Yeah.
So lots of preparation for this. Because you got like this huge magnitude to have someone like straight guitar.
Preparation, yeah. Because there's so many of them, and it is so individualistic when it comes to the mixing of the sound itself, and it's so vocal forward. It's such a vocal focus that it's important to get those technicalities right.
Yeah.
But so they do sound checks and they.
Okay, so that's allowed.
And yeah, but the first go
is
what it is, and whatever happened and whatever sound was mixed for that go, that's what happens.
Oh, fuck me.
Yeah.
So, wow, props to them.
It's really high pressure.
I want to see everyone come to the show, dude.
It is so insane. I love it.
I think some people will be really disappointed, and others will be, it will be exposed to shit, and others will be really impressed.
Utterly impressed if I, you know, I find this incredible. Because, you know, there's always that shadow of a doubt. What do they actually sound like in reality? And this is the closest you will get to actually standing in the booth with them.
I think my question sometimes is not what do they sound like. It's can you do that song that you recorded the same way if I was sitting next to you?
That's right.
You know, what would do you sound like then? Right? That's always my question. Because to what extent are you going to deceive people? And I think we're far away from those. You know, back in the industry, like even... people would lip sync, and it was a singer that
somebody
no one knew
else's,
about.
Yeah.
Right, that was like back in the day, right? We seem to have gone away from that because now with the internet and everything like that, everyone basically is a detective.
There's no way of keeping that
nah,
secret.
Nah, nah. And it's like, especially in the Korean industry, given their backgrounds, the training and stuff like that, I don't have a shadow of a doubt on any of, well, majority of these guys and girls all across the board on what they would sound
are
like
able to do, yeah.
live. I do, where I have doubts, and why I don't say all of them, where I do have doubts is specific songs that they do, given the fact that they're so poppy and commercial. Yeah, you're not going to sound like that live, and that's not going to sound as good live. I'm sorry, it's not your fault.
And it comes down to production, it comes to post-production, it comes down to all the makeup that we put on top of that. Because
yeah.
it doesn't, you know, it's amplifying the beauty that's already there. It's not, and those amplifiers sometimes can be deceiving.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
This is good, I love this show.
It's fantastic. It's like a doubler. They have like a doubler in like in.
Yeah, it's
the,
more yeah, probably more a doubler than. A
than it is like a flanger, yeah. It's
but
a,
they
like
seem to be like you see that those three effects that they seem to like there in first take, given the dryness of things, right?
Mm-hmm. There's no reverb or anything.
Very rare. I don't think we've ever seen anyone use a reverb.
No.
Right?
No. Or delay or anything like that, because it's just one go, so there's no way of fixing
yeah,
as they
true,
go.
Right?
So, yeah,
maybe
yeah.
a button.
Yeah,
go on,
no.
Then.
See, that's hard. That's really hard. I love that guy.
a good track, dude.
Yeah. It's very Stray Kids as well. Like, it didn't lose the Stray Kids sound aesthetic to it all.
But I think they also suit really well. Like, even their previous video, you know, the previous combo they had.
Thunderous.
Yeah, that would suit, like, an anime type of thing. Or, you 100%. Know, you know, like, my complete different fucking country. But it's like, you know, Shang-Chi, the movie. It would be like a track for that as well, just for the martial arts aspect of it. In anime, I know there's a lot of like fighting
combat,
and cool scenes.
Yeah.
So maybe, yeah, that's what brought me to. Go on.
Yeah, no, I agree. Yeah, we finished. All right.
Was that good?
Wow.
Well, I love
it. Yeah, it happens so fast.
It's a short track compared to for like 1 second. Yeah.
Did I miss my part? That was fast,
yeah.
I interested that he said that. What? Do they usually like to record sitting down?
No, that means that they have been singing this song for promotions, probably sitting down.
Ah, right.
So it must be nice to have a dynamic change.
That's good. Look at that. Lisa and Uru.
Saikai.
Saikai.
That sounds cool.
I've never seen that in a collaborative environment.
That would be awesome.
Yeah, let us know if you'd like us to do that.
Listen, this whole idea of having a, you know, a complete set of singers and rappers come together and deliver in such a vulnerable environment is actually so refreshing, because you also get to see, you know, the level of the rap. It's high because of their understanding of singing, because they're great singers. Then the rap is, you know, elite. It is very close to what I always say about the Filipino rap industry. The fact that they can sing aids so much their rapping abilities, because it's not only about the delivery of the rhythmicality, but what can you do in this life environments where everything literally depends on the voice and is not aided by anything else. And this is cool.
There's one more.
Oh, there's one more. Oh yeah, the Fullmetal Alchemist.
Yeah, this has been really requested.
Indeed.
That's why I want to do
it. I'm so sorry. Sorry, I totally completely forgot.
It's called Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood again. And I don't know. It's the opening.
Is the opening number okay?
And it's Anna Lee.
Amalie.
Amalie.
Amalie. Right. Let's have a look. It's loading though. I don't know why we're loading.
YouTube has that thing, right? It's like if you have a playlist, everything turns so slow.
It's like, why are you doing that?
On a computer, anyways. On the phone, it usually works fine.
I don't know why is it doing that. La 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 la.
Oh yeah,
do
tune in this Sunday. Omega X.
Yes.
Coming on the podcast. I know it's been delayed from last week, but now like translations and everything is all being sorted. So happy days, do tune in there, 12 PM UK time, Future Friday Plus.
That's it indeed.
Let's give this a go.
Let's have a look.
It's the English
version.
Fullmetal
Alchemist, Brotherhood again, but...
English version.
The English version.
Would you like to look for the Japanese version?
Absolutely.
That one's bloody popular though.
Yeah, I know, that's why I picked it. But let's see, I don't know what...
Genshin Impact. I've seen ads of that.
Have you?
Yeah, it's like a mobile game, right?
Again, was it Attack on Titans?
She did it. Probably just
English?
Search up me in the search bar.
Sure, no problem. You're right. Again.
Yeah, that's
the Metal Alchemist.
Well, it's the first thing that comes up when people search up again.
Wow.
6 years ago.
Oh wow.
Maybe that one.
I don't know.
Maybe the first one.
This one?
Opening one. That's in Japanese.
Okay. I'm so sorry about that. I picked the wrong version.
Doesn't matter.
So for anyone listening out there, it's really weird. La 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 la.
I think it's probably best to listen to like the Japanese one.
Yeah, of course.
To do it justice, right?
Yeah. Zizi has lyrics.
Or maybe... The one in the... I doubt there will be an English song at the opening of an anime.
No, most likely. It usually is, you know... think this is a lyric for a video. Okay. Oh my god, I'm so sorry, the stupid computer is lagging like hell.
Do this. Yeah, just do that.
Alright.
And I'll put it in full screen.
Yay!
Don't need to panic.
That's alright, I do panic.
There you go, look.
Let's go, I got it this time.
But also rock, all this sort of music.
This is lower though.
Nice. Yeah, the screen's going mad.
The drumming's nuts. I like that. Reminds me of Alter Bridge. Do you remember the band?
No.
I love when she does that part. This part is great.
Throw on a matapeg over there. Like,
yeah, it's really cool.
Syllabic. I'm sure people learn this so far.
It's a great track. It's a freaking great track.
I'm sure people learn this, like even though if you didn't speak Korean, I'm sure they probably...
This is Japanese.
Sorry, Japanese. If they didn't speak Japanese, they still manage somehow. Because it's a very syllabic language, like bunang ni nante. Like I guess anyone could kind of pronounce that. Now with whether you know what you're saying, who the fuck knows?
Well, especially if it's romantic, like...
Romanticized.
Romanticized.
Not romanticized. That means lovey-dovey.
That's right. But yeah, the fact that it's romanticized, it really helps you like... learn the language in a phonetic way. Cool. So yeah, it's really cool. I really like though the use of rock like arrangements that are not very heavy because it's like alternative rock. Like it reminds me of Alter Bridge.
This is probably the softest one we've heard.
Yeah, I agree.
Of all of them.
I also the most predictable in the way of like the structure of the song, it works itself.
Yes.
It's not so crazy, although it's really dynamic and it keeps you really hooked. So yeah, cool. No, I like it though.
See maybe how it finishes.
Yep. Maybe be too early to call.
Now it's gonna change.
Yeah, definitely a break somewhere.
Okay.
Didn't see that coming. Nice. See, very, very easy to listen to though.
One of my favorite ones of today.
Great guitar solo. Woo! Good dynamics! I like it.
like a mother trying to replicate it. They don't say the R's. La.
Ah, right.
Well, Shiteru, I guess. Naru as well.
Yes! This is a great track. I wonder when it came out. It's great, Mama, isn't it?
Yeah, I think that's probably one of the most sort of it has a lot of replayable value.
I agree.
That's probably my only concern with all these songs. However, obviously.
Well, then again, we already covered that earlier, right? So, what year did this come out? 2017, actually.
No, it did not. 2015, it was posted.
So when did the song come out then?
We go to the original. So go here. Came out. Oh shit, I don't know. No idea.
It's hard to tell, huh? Don't actually know.
Released 2009.
I was gonna say, it gives me that edge, that era of 2007 to 2010 type of like alternative rock that was really popular in those three, four years.
What I was just gonna say is, obviously, my only concern is obviously repairability, value, all this mm-hmm. stuff. But that's obviously. It shouldn't be.
Great.
No, but it shouldn't be a problem, right? Because this is in the opening scene of every fucking episode.
Therefore, the reason why they become so popular.
Yeah, so replayability value, it's there. Maybe replayability value as a whole, perhaps it may take a toll. But
I think between the Naruto, Bluebird, and
Until Now.
And Again, I think those are the two songs that I honestly feel like I would play on my
The Stray Kids would also probably repeat that one,
but then again I feel like I'm listening to a Stray Kids song, because it didn't feel very alien away from their straight like signature sound. I thought they were very, very dynamic, and they continued their concept through the storytelling of the OST too.
Yeah,
it's pretty cool.
I think
TXT was really impressive, though, I'm not gonna lie.
I think, like, I think probably the reason why this isn't, like, every song is gonna be on my playlist is because it's mainly rock. And I think, I've expressed it. This is something that a lot of you guys were saying. It's like, you know, I'm actually a bit worried for this podcast. I hope everyone enjoys it. Because it's mainly rock.
Yeah.
But it's enjoyable, given its complexity. And obviously, given also its musical value and the value of discussion. Whether there's gonna be all these songs on my playlist, really doubt so. But, for example, when I watch Attack on Titan and Naruto, I used to love those songs.
Yeah.
Like, I used to get really pumped about them.
And that would be one of the parts of the, as you're watching experience that you wouldn't want to miss from the series itself.
It's like in the Avengers movie.
Yeah.
Avengers.
Dun, 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 dun. Dun, 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 dun.
The Avengers theme song.
Yeah, 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 of course.
Not gonna fucking play that on repeat. On your free time.
No, but whenever it comes on, you're never gonna skip it. Exactly, and it gives you pumped. You're ready, and you're singing along, and you're ready
that's
to
right.
go. And it's
different. It has different requirements.
That's right.
But it meets them really well.
I totally agree. I think we've been, you know, if you're listening to the songs, totally isolated from the fact that they are OSTs, you might encounter certain concerns. But because they are so intertwined and so interlinked with the watching experience of an OST from an anime, I mean, you all those doubts and perhaps difficulties for marketability value
go out the window
instantly. So this is really cool. I like it. It actually makes me want to watch more animes now.
It does its job, right? Well,
it really does.
Let us know what you thought about it, and maybe if you'd like us to check out more of this, it would be super interesting to do a part two. Perhaps mm-hmm. if there are sort of like other OSTs or animes that have a radically different sort of a
feel
or take into because usually it seems to be very rocky. I'm more than open to check more of them out. I hope you guys also enjoy this. But yeah, do tune in on Sunday, Feature Friday Plus, 12 PM UK time, Omega X. They're a K-pop group that just debuted in June.
That's right.
And they have one of the fastest comebacks that I can remember myself. By literally coming back the next month.
That's right,
of
that's
what's,
right.
The comeback is called What's Going On. And yeah,
it's freaking fire, and you guys should check it out. So tune in this Sunday at 12 PM UK time to get to know them.
They're a good bunch of lads, and also the store is super cool as well. They're because great. they're really like fully pros, you know. They've been doing this shit for a little while, so even though their group is fairly new, they're all basically stars in their own right.
Absolutely.
So yeah, do tune in, and apart from that, goodbye.
That's it, people.